glorified in this place on today. Oh God, shine upon us and rest upon us. Somebody need you. Somebody been waiting all night long. Said, if I could just make it to the house of the Lord, I'd be all right. And here we are, oh God, leaning and depending on you. Speak a word into our hearts. Speak a word into our spirit, man, God. We want to grow in knowledge and in grace, oh God. Use us as instruments for your ministry, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And if you do this, we'll be thankful. We are grateful people. Thankful people clap their hands. Grateful people open their mouths and tell the Lord, thank you. Hallelujah. Because the more you thank him, hallelujah. Come on, keep thanking him. The more he'll bless you, the blesser and the blessing shall come down. That's it. If he hasn't done anything for you, you just stand there. I'm not talking to you, but I'm talking to somebody that God has made a way for. I'm talking to somebody that was sick and the doctor said he didn't know what to do, but God raised you. I'm talking to people that were broke and didn't have no money and no friend to borrow money from. And God made a way, and now he made you the lender and not the borrower. I'm talking about folks that used to live out on the street, and now you have your own home. You have your own business. You got your own transportation. You're not waiting on a bus. That's who I'm talking to. Those are grateful people. People that walked in here by the grace of God. Those are the people that are clapping their hands. People that got food in the refrigerator. Hallelujah. An extra suit in the closet. An extra pair of shoes. My tank is on full. I wear brown today. I wear black tomorrow if I want to. Clap your hands and tell the Lord thank you. Listen, we all got something to be thankful for. The bird didn't get out the cage. The fish didn't jump out the tank. My dog came back home last night. Fluffy didn't run away. Somebody clap your hands and tell the Lord thank you. Lord, I'm thankful unto you. I could have been in the hospital. Could have been in that fine cemetery that I drove by to get here. But you kept me.
Help me. Thank you,
and I love you.
Yes,
hey,
you, Lord.
And my God.
Thank you, Lord.
And I thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And I magnify you.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
And I give you glory.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Because you're the best thing that ever happened to me. I search high and low. I can't find nobody like you.
Yes.
I don't have a problem lifting my hands unto you, oh God. Glorified, oh God. You get the glory. I ain't nothing but some dirt that you blew your breath into. You get the glory. Hallelujah. Get the glory. Here's my hands. Here's my voice. Hey, get the glory, oh God. Get the glory out of my life. Make me better, Lord. I want to be better. Anybody want to be better this morning? Tell him, Lord, I want to do better. I want to be better. Work in me. Work in me, Lord. Create in me a clean heart. And renew the right spirit within me. Oh, God. Oh, God, this morning. Hey, speak a word, Lord. Speak a word, Lord. And I'll obey. Speak a word. Lord, give me an ear to hear what the Spirit have to say to the church.
Thank you, Lord.
Bread of heaven.
Yes.
Bread of heaven.
Thank you, God.
Feed me.
Hallelujah.
Till I want no more. In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
In the name of
Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And the people of God give you the highest praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
So we lift our voice, we lift our eyes, we lift our hands unto a holy God.
Hallelujah.
Oh, you're so strong and mighty.
Yes.
Come on, clap your hands and praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
We worship you. for who you are. We praise you for you are God. We thank you for all you've done, sending us your Son. So high, flaunt the stars in the space. We worship you.
We worship you.
Down unto him who's able to keep you from falling, from falling, from falling.
We worship you.
Down unto him who's able to do exceedingly abundantly.
We worship you.
And we give you glory, we give you honor.
We worship you.
Somebody wave your hands like banners and say, God, I adore you.
We worship you.
And we gathered in your name to worship you.
We worship you
for who you are. We worship you for who you are. I want you to clap your hands for God. That's all you got for him. He's a big God. He deserves a big praise. Look at somebody and tell them, I came to give God glory. Can you clap like this this morning? I'm sorry, I'm toe up. I'm so glad to be here. I'm just about ready to run the 6 mile. God is so good. Hey, go. Hey. Oh, good God Almighty. Unto you, oh God. Unto you, oh God. Hey, be glorified. That's it. Let's do it together. Let's do it together. Glory, glory, glory to our King.
Glory, glory, glory to our King.
To the Lamb that was slain for my being.
To the Lamb that was slain for my being.
Glory, glory, glory to our King.
Glory, glory, glory to our King.
To the Lamb that was slain for my being.
To the Lamb that was slain for our being.
We cry, for our being.
To the Lamb that was slain for our being.
Holy, holy, holy to our King.
Holy, holy, holy to our King.
To the Lamb that was slain for our being.
To the Lamb that was slain for our being.
Say that again. Glory, glory,
glory.
brothers here, there's fellas here, saints. Somebody needs you to give them a hug this morning. Somebody need a handshake. Somebody needs you to tell them it's good to see you in the house of the Lord.
My name is Evangelist Lorraine Hinton, and we're standing all over the sanctuary. It is at this time we're going to affirm what we believe. And the affirmation of faith can be found on either screens to my left, my right. So let us affirm what we believe. Our belief concerning the Bible. We believe the Bible to be the inspired and only infallible written word of God. Our belief concerning God. We believe that there is one God, eternally existence in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Our belief concerning the church. We believe in the blessed hope. which is the rapture of the church of God, which is in Christ at his return. Our belief concerning sin. We believe that the only means of being cleansed from sin is through repentance, faith in the precious blood of Jesus Christ, and accepting the gospel according to Romans 10, 9, and 10. Our belief concerning salvation. We believe that the regeneration by the Holy Ghost is absolutely essential for personal salvation. Our belief concerning Christ. We believe that the redemptive work of Christ on the cross provides healing for the human body in answer to believing in prayer. Our belief concerning the Holy Ghost. We believe that the baptism in the Holy Ghost, according to Acts 2 and 4, is given to believers who ask for it. Our belief concerning sanctification. We believe in the sanctifying power of the Holy Ghost, by whose indwelling the Christian is enabled to live a holy and separated life in this present world. Amen.
Trouble! changed my walk.
Yeah. Oh,
he changed my talk.
Yeah. Oh,
where I used to go,
you out of something, why don't you put your hands together and give him some praise? He brung me out of some things. Sister Valor, I know he brung you out of some things. Hallelujah. Angel, he brung you out of some stuff. Mama Brooks, he brung you out. Stella Means, he done brung you out of some things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother Johnson, he done brung you out. Brother Thompson. Glory to God. Is that all? Is that all you can give him? He done brung you out of some things. And if you sit on God, he'll sit on you. Oh my. Hallelujah. Yes. Glory to God. Come on, put your hands together and give him some praise. Hallelujah. All the praisers, stand on your feet and give him a thunderous shout. Because God has brung you out. He's making a way for you right now. There's some doors that are opening in a supernatural that's going to manifest in the... Hallelujah. Mm-mm-mm. Hallelujah. My name is Elder Kevin Owsley. It's time for tithe and offering. We're asking all the tithers to stand to your feet, and those of you that are paying your tithe, we ask that you move your respective aisles. Those of you who are watching by stream, go to hit the E button on the left-hand side of your screen, and you can pay your tithe right there on online. And those of you that have your smartphones, you can go to www.geikojic.org and push on the e-giving button. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. God of heaven, we certainly thank you. We bless you and you honor you, Lord God, for your goodness and your mercies towards us. Thank you, O God, for ways that you're making, O God, doors that you're opening, Lord God, doors that you're creating for us, O God, your people. And as we pay our tithe, O God, we pray that you bless, O God, sanctify and stretch it for the sake of this house as well as for our personal house. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. We thank you and say amen.
Your tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, saith the Lord. Try me now and see.
Is anybody excited on today? Anybody just excited to be alive? You're excited about what's going on in your life. You're excited about knowing Jesus. You're excited about him moving in your life. You're excited about what he has in store for you. Anybody excited about anything on today? And if you're excited about just being being in the house of God, why don't you stand to your feet? Stand up, stand up, stand up. Because I'm excited about the things of God. And why I ask you to stand up, because when you stand up, you start beginning to think of why I was able to stand up. That's something to be excited about, because you was able to stand up on your own two feet, because somebody is yet laying down in the hospital bed right now. They can't get up, but you came to the house of God on this morning and stood up on your feet to give God a hand clap of praise and tell him thank you. I'm excited because I believe there's some doors are opening for us right now. I believe I see some things happening, and I know things don't make, they may not look good in your life right now, but bless God, he is doing some things in your life, but you gotta see it behind what you see. Okay, let me explain this a little bit to you. You're seeing things too much in the natural, but I want you to look beyond what you see in the natural and look into the spirit realm. Just remember what Bishop been telling us for years. He said, if you can't see it before you see it, well, he's not talking about a natural sight. Oh, my God, today. So he's got to be talking about a spiritual sight. In other words, the scripture tells us that we can begin to imagine. Hallelujah. Imagine the things that we're believing for God for. That's the spiritual sight. So how many of y'all imagining some things right now? Can you imagine yourself in your nice home? Can you imagine yourself driving down the street with your nice car? Can you imagine yourself having your bank account that reads $300,000 and that's surplus? Hallelujah. All your bills are paid. Glory to God. Can you imagine your body just being healed and you walking around shouting and giving God glory? Can you imagine your family members all lined up and they saw saved and sanctified, Holy Ghost filled and fire baptized? Can you just imagine folk on your job treating you better than what they've been treating you? Can you imagine somebody just walking up to you, slipping $1,000 in your hand? What can you imagine from God? Those very things that you can imagine, I want you to get it in your hand, and I want you to give God glory for what you can imagine God to do. How is that the best you can do? Come on, give God some glory. Come on, people of God, shake it off. God is trying to bless you. Mother, he's trying to bless you. So get an offering. Get an offering in your hand, and whatever you get, imagine what that could be. Oh, y'all not thinking right. Imagine, imagine. So if you get $20 in your hand, what you think it could be? Somebody said it. Who said that? Come on now, brother. That's what I'm talking about. You got to begin to put it into your imagination. Everybody standing with something in your hand. Greater Emmanuel, you know how we do. If there's somebody seated around us, that may be an indication that they don't have anything to give. Would you slip something in their hand? I want you to be a blessing to somebody else. Slip something in their hand that they can stand up. So all should be standing. Those that can stand, please stand. Amen. Somebody say amen. All that can stand, praise God, please stand. Amen. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. God of heaven, we certainly love you and we adore you, Lord God, because we know that you are our burden bearer. You are the one who makes ways for us, oh God. You're the one who opens doors for us, oh God. And we can imagine, oh God, the blessings of the Lord that maketh us rich and add no sorrow to it. So we thank you right now, dear God. As we plant seed into this fertile ground, we asking you, Lord God, to bring those things that we can imagine to pass, oh God. And we give you glory for it right now. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. The ushers are leading you out from the rear. Amen.
Praise the Lord, Greater Emmanuel. Please focus your attention on these very important ministry announcements. Today, Ministry Coordinator Joanne Brown would like to meet with the members of the CWC, YWCC, Nurses Guild, Singles Ministry, and the Single Parent Ministry in the Cathedral Choir Stand immediately following 11:30 a.m. worship service. The Kids with Voices for Jesus will rehearse at 7 p.m. Wednesday, February 10th during Midweek Motivation. Please see Sister Tasha Nolan for more information. The Senior Connect meeting will be held Friday, February 12th at 6 p.m. in Conference Room A. And then at 7 p.m., the Women and Men's Department of Greater Emmanuel present a special evening of breakout sessions. These informative gatherings will run concurrently. All members are encouraged to attend. The Trailblazers present a trip to see Monster Jam, Saturday, February 27th. Tickets are just $17 per child if purchased by Friday, February 12th. For more information, see Evangelist Nikenta Royals. All are welcome to participate in the prayer lock-in on Tuesday, February 16th at 5 a.m. in the temple. Doors will be locked promptly at 5:15 a.m. The Single Parent Ministry will meet at 6 p.m. in the social area Thursday, February 18th. All single parents are encouraged to attend. Elder William Adams and Evangelist Denise Jones are the coordinators. The Greater Emmanuel Food Distribution Ministry and our partners, Forgotten Harvest and Gleaners Community Food Bank, will distribute food Saturday, February 20th, from 11 a.m. until 2 p.m. on the 7-mile lot. Volunteers are needed. Please see Sister Gloria Conyers for further information. The members and parents of the Emmanuel Voices are asked to assemble for a very important meeting on Saturday, February 13th from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. in the temple. For more information, please see Elder Cadero Brown or Brother John Norwood. Your participation is appreciated in advance. Please remember our weekly services on Sundays at 7:30 a.m., Tuesdays at 12 noon and 7 p.m. are hours of prayer. Wednesdays at 11:45 a.m. and 7 p.m. is midweek motivation. And Fridays at 7 p.m. is our evangelistic service. Please come out and be blessed by these Spirit-filled services. We are Greater Emmanuel, a church driven by the cross.
Asking everyone to stand, please, as we go to the throne of grace. Father God of heaven, we thank you. We come this morning with our cups out, oh God. Lord, you're a God that sits high and you look low. We ask you now, Lord, that you'd heal now. Open doors right now. In the name of Jesus. Come now, Lord. Heal the bodies now. The blood of Jesus. Make whole now. Come now, Jesus. And open that door now, Lord. That mother and that child. Even that father, oh God. We ask you to touch now. In the name of Jesus. You can and you will, Lord. You said you'd heal us, oh God. You said you'd open doors, Lord. I'm asking you right now to open doors now for your saints. Look on the saints everywhere. Touch us now, Lord. Touch us now. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Crown the heads, oh God. Open the doors, Lord. Lord, we ask you to bless us now. We come to hear a word on today. We come to hear a word. Somebody needs you. Somebody needs you now, Lord. That mother, that child, that father, they need you now. That family, oh God. Touch them now, Lord. Touch right now, Lord. That drug addict, oh God. Touch right now, Lord. Heal the bodies, oh God. Heal the bodies now, Lord. Heal now, Lord. Undertake for us, oh God. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. Make whole now.
Make whole now. Make whole now. Stretch out your hand. Stretch out your hand. Stretch out your mighty hand. Stretch out your hand, Lord. Heal now, Lord. Heal now. The church needs you, Lord. We need you right now. Hi-yi-yi-yi-yi. Father, we ask you now, Lord. Look on our bishop, oh God. The man of God. Touch him now. 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 In the name of Jesus. Touch, oh God. Touch us. Touch us. Touch us now, Lord. Oh God. Touch Sister Sheard now, Lord. Touch her now, Lord. Touch her body, oh God. Touch her body, oh God. Look on the family, Lord. Touch them now, Lord. Touch them now, Lord. Touch them now, Lord. Lift your hands and lift your hands and tell God thank you. Tell him thank you. If God has been good to you, tell him thank you. If God has opened doors for you, tell him thank you. Now, Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. And Lord, we ask you to bless us, oh God. Undertake for us, oh God. Hold us in the hollow of your hand. Breathe on us now, Lord. Breathe on us now. In the name of Jesus, we ask you to do it now, Lord. Oh God, we thank you and we give you praise. We give you honor. These blessings we ask in Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen. The choir shall surrender their last selection, and the next voice you will hear will be of the men of God, our bishop and our leader, Bishop Sheard.
Hallelujah. Oh, I wish I had somebody that really loved the Lord. Hallelujah. Give him some praise. Give him the glory. Give him the honor. Lord, I love you today. Lord, I praise you today. There's none like you in all the earth. I praise your name. I lift you up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to give him the praise. Give him the praise. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes to your will. Yes to your way. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. He deserves the praise. He deserves the praise. He deserves the praise. He deserves the praise. Give him your best praise. Give him your best praise. Come on, Zion. Let the Redeemer of the Lord say so. Oh. If it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, I don't know where I would be. That's why I love him, because he made a way out of no way. He opened a door where there was no door. That's why I love him. When I was sick and the doctor gave up on me, he healed my body. That's why I love him. Tell your neighbor, I love him. Oh Lord. Hallelujah. While you're standing, praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. While you're yet standing, what a joy it is for me to have a dear, dear friend and brother to share with us from the word on this morning. I am so blessed that he is here. He is the pastor of the Bethel Church, and many of you know him from the Word Network. He is certainly a tremendous preacher. It's been a while since he shared with us here at Greater Emmanuel, but I am so thankful that he has consented to come and to speak to us on this morning. You're in for a treat, because he is indeed an anointed vessel of God. Please receive with a Greater Emmanuel welcome the one and only Bishop George Bloomer. Come on, say amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Help me to honor your pastor this morning. Bishop, thank you so much. And to your lovely First Lady, to the quorum of ministers in fellowship with us, and to you, the people of God, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I don't do a whole lot of talking outside of the word of the Lord. You'll find me reading from two passages of scripture. I'm so happy to be here with you on this morning. The gospel as recorded by St. Matthew's, gospel as recorded by Matthew's, chapter number 16, verse number 13, but I want you to stick a pin there and flip over to Luke's gospel, chapter number 22, and I believe it's the 31st verse. And it reads like this. It says, "And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. But I prayed for you." It's a wonderful thing to have God praying for you. "But I prayed for you that your faith fail you not. And when you are converted, strengthen your brother." The gospel as recorded by Matthew's chapter 16, verse number 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And their reply was, "Some say that you are John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah. Some have said you're just one of the prophets." But he answered and said unto them, "But whom saith ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, Son of the living God." Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed art thou, Simon, born of Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto you that you are Peter," I know who you are, "and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and I will give unto you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and I will give unto you the keys to the kingdom of heaven." Y'all gonna help me? "And I will give unto you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatsoever you shall bind on earth." Now just touch somebody and say, "See, all that stuff is already dealt with." "And whatsoever you shall loose on earth." Touch your neighbor and say, "You know, see, I already got that." Yeah, see, there's a whole lot of stuff we're worrying about that is already covered. "Whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." It's a strange part of the text, and I don't know where it goes at. Verse number 20 says, "Then charged he," or warned he, "his disciples that they should tell no one that he was the Christ." I want to minister to you from this thought. Satan wants you back real bad. Get your neighbor and say, "He wants you back real bad." Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning. We pray that the word that would go forth would be a word that you selected for your people's hearing. My obedience in delivering this word should bring us a corporate testimony that it was good for us to be here. The way that you're going to move and bless, we give your name praise in Jesus' name. Amen. My name is George Gary John Derek Bloomer. I was born in Brooklyn, New York, 453 Columbia Street, apartment A, B, and C. It's the truth. My mom and my dad had 9 children together. My dad went out of the wedding barn and had 15 other children by 6 women in Red Hook Projects. That's the truth, too. I know all them heifers that was with my daddy. And I know my brothers and my sisters. I dropped out of school in the 9th grade. I dropped out of school in the 9th grade. Thank you so much. This must be for a tall man. You know, I feel just like this. I dropped out of school in the 9th grade, and they kept on passing me from class to class to class. So by the time I dropped out of school, I couldn't read at all. I learned how to read about 23, 24 years ago, which means that all of my adult life, I couldn't read, write, or spell. And I still have some challenges with that right now, but God is good. I had a $300 a day cocaine habit. I know it was $300 because that's what I was getting from running the numbers, and I would use all that up. Later on in life, my cocaine addiction kicked in, and then I went into crack smoking. But the Lord delivered me out of that. Someone would ask the question, you know, what's up with the devil? Because we're in a time and a day now where the children of God are faced with new high-tech demons. the fear that we had for God, we can't convey that to our children. I came up on gospel movies like A Thief in the Night, Pilgrim's Progress, A Burn in Hell. You show people things like that and they give their life to the Lord. You know, people pay big money to be scared now. They pay you to scare them. And so to have a direct testimony is really, really key. The story opens up with two texts that really, really sort of kind of go together. It is Jesus meeting up with his disciples. He hears a story that the disciples are not quite sure of who he actually is. There's a lot of hearsay, a lot of talking that is going on. And so Jesus, instead of asking his disciples the question in Nazareth, he took them to a place where the question would have a little bit more meaning. He took them to Caesarea Philippi. Someone would have to ask the question, what is Caesarea Philippi? Caesarea Philippi, according to the Jewish historian Josephus, Caesarea Philippi is the place where Baal has set up his false schools of prophets. It is the octagon temple where there was eight entrances into the temple, and at the gateway of the temple there were the appearance of sodomites who committed sodomy in the gateways in order to energize the demonic forces that existed in those days. It is there where they taught wicker and sorcery, black magic, white magic, gray magic. Is there where they taught gazing through crystal balls and divination, sorcery, the burning of incense, etc. It was also in that area where these altars that were erected, where mothers brought their firstborn babies to offer them up as sacrifices unto Baal. Jesus carried his disciples in that setting so that they can see the blood dripping fresh from the altars. They can see the octagon temple. They can see the wickers and those who are working sorcery. And it's in that setting that he turns and asks them the question, whom do men say that I am? The powerful part about the text is that he doesn't just ask them the question, but he is an intelligent teacher. So he gives them the answer while asking them the question. He said, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? He gives them the answer while he is asking them the question, but their time plus time equals influence. And so the folks that they had been hanging out with, sort of kind of clouded their ability to receive the message that Jesus was teaching. It happens to all of us as pastors. Television is a wonderful, wonderful thing, but many of us as pastors are fighting the televangelists that are on TV telling our people stuff that just ain't true. And so when we come to Sunday morning message, glory be to God, we spend about 15, 20 minutes in every service shifting the house and causing things that was put on your brain to drop off. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying? To focus you because your assignment is to this house. I wish I was preaching here. And so he gathered his disciples together and he began to ask them, well, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? What are they saying about me? And the text opens up and it says, some say. And so one said, well, some say that you're John the Baptist. You know, they believed in reincarnation in those days, that when you died, you came back as someone who was great. And some say Elias or Jeremiah. And one of the disciples said, I don't know. They just said you're one of the prophets or something. I'm not sure. And Jesus turned and he says, okay, I understand that. But whom saith ye that I am? What do you say about it? And 11 of the 12 disciples had formulated no opinion as to who Jesus really, really was. Time plus time equals influence. The person that you spend the most of your time with will ultimately influence you. You know the story of Jacob going through a far country and he's walking and it gets dark, and so he takes this stone and he makes a pillow of it, and when he lays his head on this stone, this rock is Jesus, the heavens open up and a ladder stands from the earth up into the sky, and he sees angels ascending, going up and coming down. The principle of the text is who you sleep with will determine how your heavens open up. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so time plus time equals influence. No matter how much of the word is preached to you, if you're hanging around people who don't know the word, y'all are hearing what I'm saying, they will choke the word out of you. He said, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they got into this, some say. And he said, well, who do you say that I am? And 11 of the 12 disciples had formulated no opinion as to who Jesus really, really was. And then Simon Peter, the one least likely to have known, he stood up, he raised his hand, and he says, I know who you are. This is important because if you're going to have a relationship with Jesus, you will not be able to do it on hearsay, some say. You got to know who he is for yourself. Turn to your neighbor and say to your neighbor, do you know who Jesus is? Say to the other neighbor, do you know who he really, really is? it's become very, very popular for people to say that I don't do religion anymore. You know, I don't do religion anymore. I'm in relationship with God. Let me help you out for a little while. Relationship with God requires a whole lot more effort than being religious. Relationship with God, it requires a whole lot more effort than just you being in, you know, being religious. And maybe you need to go back to just being religious. All you have to do is sing two songs and come to church on Sunday and, you know, cuss people out if they get on your nerves and hang your religion up. And when you get ready, take it off the shelf and put it back on. But relationship don't work like that. Relationship is loving those that hate you and praying for those that despitefully use you. Smiling in the face of people who smile in your face and all that. See, they don't went to the club. All time won't take your place. Yes, smiling at them, rejoicing with them that hate you, doing good to folk that don't do right by you, and keeping your joy in spite of all of it. The one least likely to have known stood up and said, I know who you are. I know who you are. And not only do I know who you are, I know where you come from. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus is stunned in the text as he reaches back and he says, blessed art thou, Simon, born of Jonah. In other words, I know who you are and I know where you come from. But what Jesus' information was natural information, but Peter's information was divine. Peter had a divine connection with God, and he was least likely to have known who Jesus was, because when Peter came on the Lord's side, he kept his knife because he knew that somebody's ear was going to have to come off. Every now and then, you got one of those people, glory be to God, to look at them on the outside. It simply don't look like they have God, but there's something going on the inside. Can I preach to somebody in here? That requires the change. And the Lord turned and said unto him, he said, wow, blessed art thou, Simon, born of Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, but my Father which is in heaven. In other words, you've had a relationship with God, with my Father in heaven, and you are Simon, you are Peter. Peter, Petros is where we get the word pebble from, or petrified. He said, I'm going to take your confession, and I'm going to turn your confession into a rock. Anytime you get a divine revelation from glory, God makes you a rock. I'm going to take the pebble of your existence and I'm going to make it a rock, a mountain. And upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And then he says, listen, I'm going to give you keys to the kingdom. Whatsoever things you bind on earth. Keys represents concepts. It represents ideas. It represents principles. I'm going to give you concepts. I'm going to give you ideas. I'm going to give you principles. So you'll be able, glory be to God, in the face of adversity, you'll have a key. I'm going to give you authority to walk in a supernatural authority. Now, as I told you, I just learned how to read 23 years ago. I'm 50-something years old now. Something years old right now. All of my days I couldn't read writing, but God gave me a key. Gives me authority. And along with it, he wants to give you a testimony. And the testimony is not thanking the Lord for your life, health, and strength, food on the table, or clothes on your back. That's a speech in a storefront church when you're waiting for more people to come. A testimony is an undeniable experience that you've had with God in the past to sustain you for any present or futuristical difficulties. A testimony is data and proof that the God that brought you out before will turn around and do it again. Is there anybody in here that has a testimony? The scriptures teach us that you overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of your testimony. Look at your neighbor and say, be careful how you deal with me. I might be your answer. See, that's the deal. Because the hell that you're going through might not have anything to do with you. It might have everything to do with who God is anointing you to share your testimony with. They'll go through hell for a long, long time until they hear the word of the Lord coming out of your mouth. It's very, very important. I remember coming up as a young boy, you know, with all the challenges of the projects, growing up on government cheese and government butter, powdered eggs and powdered milk and pumes and raisins and you know, a lot of kids, when we were coming up, they had this dream: when I grow up, I'm going to be a doctor. When I grow up, I'm going to be a lawyer. When I grow up, what you going to do? I said, when I grow up, I'm going to get me some milk, because I was tired. I'm going to get me some milk and some cereal. Y'all are hearing what I'm saying? Because they, from the welfare, they used to bring us those wheat And as soon as you put it in the milk, it just, and I said, I'm going to get me some Captain Crunch, and I'm going to go cuckoo for Cocoa Pops, and I'm going to have, y'all ain't hear what I'm saying, Frosted Freaks, they're great. That's all I was thinking about when I would grow up. I found myself on the wrong side of the tracks. Grandpa Bloomer was a preacher. My dad never picked up the tasks and what have you, and it flipped over his generation, fell back into my lap, and I didn't understand what was happening, what was going on. It was a generational blessing and a generational thing that was transpiring, but not before I would go through the valleys of the shadows in order to get my testimony. Can I preach for a little while? And so I started working with the gangs in my area and hanging out with the drug dealers, the groups that I was in. We was pulling in about $100,000 a week. That's the truth, about $100,000 a week. There is no stores, there is no banks, there is nobody that you can hide the money. I told you, Satan wants your back real bad. And I was very, very, very good at what I did. And when we started making this kind of money, I had no dreams, no aspirations. All I wanted was a pair of Levi dungaree pants and a pair of white shell Adidas, a few chains and some money to go to Tony Roma's, and I was fine. Had no idea of the wealth that was passing through my hands. Great day in the morning, 100K a week. Wasn't my money, but it was the crew's money. No place to hide it, so we would get these abandoned buildings on Lorraine Street in Columbia and go into the basement of the abandoned buildings and cut holes in the floor and pour cement in there and make vaults, and that's where we were dumping the cash. And then we would go to our Latino friends, and they would get us, buy us. We would buy rats from them and put rats inside the building and spread pumpkin seeds, rice, and sunflower seeds, and feed the rats water so that they fester. Early in the morning, you could be walking and you see drug addicts outside in front of the building, because we would give drug addicts free drugs just to smoke and shoot up in front of the buildings that was holding our investment in the basement. And you'd walk past that building, so many rats in there, the rats was coming out in the daytime. You were, oh, rats in the daytime. You would see rats. We did that to keep people from going in those abandoned buildings. Some of y'all gonna walk by Detroit and see an abandoned building, a rat come down and say, I'm going in that mother today. Might be some money. Might be telling you a few secrets of the kingdom. I became my best customer. I became my best customer. Worst thing I ever did was to test the product. But the anointing of the Lord was on my life even when I was in trouble. And I know that doesn't sound too good to many of you, because a lot of you think that you're anointed because you prayed your way there. You think that you're anointed of something you did. All of your righteousness is filthy. This is a plan that came from God. Your mother's 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 mother put some time in that is showing up in your life right now. And you better thank God for it. It's a generational thing. So I, that the enemy begins to fight me from time to time, and he battles with me, and my life is surrendered to the Lord. I was sharing some testimonies with some folks in the program that we service, and for 23, 24 years, every free Monday that I have or Thursday that I have, I still go to the program, and I just step in the program, listen to the program to see, because there's new stuff coming out, and so I just step in the program, make sure that nothing new, slips up on me. And I was talking to the group there and sharing with them what I went through and how the Lord delivered me and how he brought me out. And I said, because I'm a crack addict. And one of the ladies came to me and she said, you used to be a crack addict. And I said, no, I'm a crack addict. Now you, the devil is a liar. You used to be a crack addict. See, what she don't understand. I understand what she's saying, but she doesn't understand. She said, I used to be a crack addict. No, I'm a crack addict in remission. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. I'm a crack addict in remission, just like you have a lot of people in the church who are whores in remission. You're not doing it today. But if you don't keep on praying, who you was comes back seven times stronger. Y'all don't want me to preach in here. I'm sorry, maybe the wrong church. I'm so sorry. Thieves in this house in remission. Molesters in remission. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. When you have cancer and they get the cancer out of your body, they come and they tell you your cancer is what? In remission. it's remitted, which means that it's there, but it's not strong enough. There's no cells hosting it. But if you don't eat right, if you don't sleep right, if you allow stress to creep back in, that thing comes back stronger than it was before. The Bible says when a house is swept and it's garnished and the spirit goes out, it goes into the dry places seeking spirits, seven spirits worse than them, in order to return back to the house. I'm telling you this morning, the devil wants you back bad. He wants me back bad, and I know he wants me back bad. There was a few years ago, glory be to God, maybe about 18, 19 years ago, I found myself climbing and reaching a place of ministerial success, and at the same time shooting up 20 minutes before it was time to preach. All the sanctified people who see in the spirit couldn't see that. Makes me wonder what's really, really going on around here. In the name of Jesus. Yes, sir. I was preaching at a church and I couldn't come out of the pastor's study because I shot up 20 minutes before it was time for me to preach. When the demon spirit comes after you, and he comes after your children, he comes after a house that he used to possess, he still thinks that it's his. So he goes to find a spirit that has a skeleton key to let him back in. And by the time you get there, he's sitting in the living room. And if we don't bind a strong man, he's coming back. I feel like preaching to somebody this morning. I told you the devil wants you back real, real bad. And it's in this hour and in this season where the enemy is playing all different types of games with us. This is why he's situating our music. He's changing our music. He's changing the way that our worship goes. Glory be to God. He's changing it. He's got us singing songs where the name of the Lord is not mentioned. Y'all ain't here at all. He's got us singing stuff where there's no blood attached to it. There's no redeeming power. It's good music, glory be to God, but there's no message there. What he's does doing is desensitizing us so he can show up and shift the house. I was so happy to come in here this morning to hear church and to feel church, and y'all are here and the choir still singing, the anointing is still flowing, and it's hard to stop us because we know who Jesus is. Touch two people and say, I know who he is. I know who he is. So I found myself in that type of predicament, and the Lord resting on my life. I've had preachers to get upset with me and say, I don't like when you get up there and you be telling that story. Well, you know, don't bother me about my testimony. You worry about your own. You get your own testimony, and then you'll understand what I'm talking about. I was one of the presenters for the Bible Experience that they done. They had 400 actors, and Blair Underwood, and this one and that one, Oscar performing actors and what have you, and little old me, and I could barely read, and they made me the voice of the demons in the Bible Experience. And so someone had found out that I had just learned how to read not too long ago, and that was a phenomenal piece and a selling point that they was going to use with the Bible Experience. And so they did an article, the News and Observer did an article, and that article was picked up by other newspapers, and it just went everywhere, and a few people was calling me, congratulating me. That's wonderful. I saw you in the newspaper, and they put you on the front page, and that was wonderful. But a preacher called me and says, man, that was good, but I got a question to ask you. Why did they do the story on you, and they didn't do it on me? I thought to myself, the audacity of this guy calling me, it was another name I wanted to call him, this guy calling me, asking me that question. And he kept on going in. And he said, because, you know, my church is bigger than yours, and I'm more, you know, so finally I got mad, and I said, listen, did you read the article? He said, what you mean? I said, did you read the article? The article was about a person who dropped out of school, could not read, was illiterate, and smoked crack, was in jail with 18 years and got out in 18 months. That's what they're. If you want them to do an article on you, then you got to do what I did. So go and smoke some crack. Drop out of school. This is not competition on where the Lord has brought you from and what the Lord has brought you through and what the Lord has brought you out. This is thanking God for bringing me this far. Give me 2 minutes, I'll be out of your way. Touch your neighbor and say, he wants you back real bad. He wants you back real bad. This is the battle that we're having right now. This is the battle that we're having right now. Satan's got a plan to take our churches and turn them upside down and shake the church like it's a salt shaker. Or his deal is to shake every one of you out of this place. His deal is to be your social media pastor. His deal, glory be to God, is to get you so disconnected from the functions of how God's body is supposed to work. work. Do you not realize that Time Magazine put an article out just a few weeks ago on the heels of what ISA is doing and diverted the attention? And this article says that four out of every seven teens in America, four out of every seven teens in America between the ages of 13 and 27 years old is smoking marijuana. That means that you got folks who are playing our music in church smoking marijuana. Y'all ain't hearing what we live in a desensitized society. Because no one knows who Jesus really is. Because we're finding out who Jesus is from hearsay, and we don't know who he is for ourselves. So the hell that you're going through is a plan of God to allow you to go through, and then he brings you out. And once God brings you out, can't nobody change your mind as to who he is. High five somebody, say, I know who he is. I've been through enough hell and I've been through enough storms to know exactly who he is. The final part of the text tells us this particular thing. He says, Simon, now that you know who I am, I want you to know that I had a conversation the other day with Lucifer. Lucifer came to me and he's requesting to have you. That word request there in the Greek doesn't mean request like you put in a ask for permission. What it actually means in the Greek, it means that he's demanding because he has the rights. So somewhere along the line, Simon cracked open up the door, and now this spirit has the right to go in and get him. He says, Simon, Simon, Satan has requested, he's demanding to have you, and we got to turn you over to him. But I'm praying for you. Intercession. Intercession. Intercession is not praying for people. When you are an intercessor, you don't pray for people. Intercessors don't pray for people. Intercessors praise as the person and not for the person. Did you just catch that? This is why intercessors go through so much, because we bear the infirmities of those weak who can't bear it themselves. Great day in the morning. And you got to be very careful that your intercession doesn't become your attack. That you enter the seed and enter the session, and when it's over, get out and go sit down. Y'all ain't hear what I'm saying? And don't go looking for credit for somebody. You know, I really prayed and interceded for it. Shut your mouth. Do your job. It ain't my business what God assigned you to do. Intercede. Into the seed, into the session. When the session is over, go and sit down. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. I don't want to hear it. You don't get no badge for entering the session. And he says, but I have prayed for you that your faith fail you not. And watch what he says. When you are converted, which means that you're going to fall. You're going to fall. But when you come back, give a testimony. When thou converted, go and strengthen your brother. Satan wants you back real bad. 7 months ago, I got a telephone call from a friend of mine who I knew back in the game. I was happy to hear from him. He said, Bloom, I want to talk to you. He said, I'm saved now and I love God. I said, wonderful. Because this dude was something else. And he came to see me, dressed, put together, and he had a book bag on, knapsack on. He sat down, he says, I've been watching you on television, and the Lord laid it on my heart to build your church from the ground up. I said, thank you, Jesus. I'm build your church from the ground up. I said, well, you know, Doc, I don't really want to build the church from the ground up. I don't want to go through all that. But there's a building in town that I would like to have, and it would fit my ministry needs. He said, how much is it? I said, it's $7 million. He said, I'm going to pay for that building for you, $7 million. Now, the building was $5 million, but I told him $7. No, I did tell him $7, because you got to get cameras, and you got to have music and stuff, and then you got to have a little something for later. Praise the Lord, somebody. Since you buying. He said, the Lord spoke to me and told me to build your church from the ground up. True story, I'm telling you the truth. The truth. And I said to him, I said, okay, wow, my God. He pulled the knapsack off, zipped it open, and in my office dumped $1 million on that desk. Stacks of $10,000. One fell on the floor over next to the desk. I kept on looking at his eye, hoping he didn't see that. I'm going to get me some of this money. He said, I'm going to build this church for you from the ground up. He says, but Bloomer, I need you to do something for me. He says, I got $17 million that I need you to help me clean up. They used to call it laundering. Now they call it cleansing. I got $17 million I need you to help me clean up. So we're going to buy some phony businesses, attach the businesses to the church, and you cleanse the money. You keep 40 cents on every dollar. You give me 60 cents. And when it's all done, you'll have your $7 million. And plus, you can have the phony businesses that we set up. I said, the devil is a liar. I started talking to him. I said, you got to stop this. And that's what I was saying out my mouth. But in my head, I'm sorry, I'm messing up the church. In my head, I was trying to figure out, how in the world can I do this thing? I done lost some people who've been praying for me. It's like, I can't believe Bishop Bloomer said. It's the truth. In my head, and out of my mouth, I'm saying, Doc, no, I can't fool with that. And get involved with that. You need to stop that. You need to really give your life to the Lord. You done made so much money. You already got $17 million. Stop. What you the game? And I'm talking to him. But in my head, Bishop, I'm working out the deal in my head. He said, Doc, I said, I can't do it. He picked the money up, started putting it in the bag, and what have you. And I said, well, Doc, you could pay your tithe. That Negro wouldn't even pay no tithe. And I kept my eye on him because, you know, we had that $10,000 on the floor and stuff like that. And I was hoping that he didn't see it, you know. He walked right on over there, picked it up, and put it in the bag. And left me with the thought in my head. And so for about 2-3 weeks, I'm calling. I saw this building complex that was up for sale, 273 units. Called a friend of mine and said, how would you like to manage one of my units for me? I'm started spending the money the guys here. It's going on in my head. The Lord spoke to me in our early morning prayer, and he says, I want you to call your staff together, and I want you to call your leadership in the church together, and I want you to tell them to stop backsliding. Now, I heard God say that, but God was saying something to me. He was telling me to tell them to stop backsliding. He was saying to me, don't you start. Because I was getting ready too. And so he's telling me, don't start, and telling them to stop. And so I'm sitting in the boardroom on the second level of the church, and it's packed that day. And I'm talking to them about what the Lord spoke to me. And one of my assistants comes in, he said, there's somebody needs to. I said, God, we in a staff meeting. He said, no, you got to step outside. I stepped outside into the hallway, and standing in the hallway, Bishop, was a FBI agent and a state trooper. 3 weeks later. FBI agent, state trooper, standing in the hallway. And I said, Mr. Bishop Bloom? I said, yes. He said, can I speak to you for a moment? I said, come to my office. Went to the office. Opened up a file. Said, do you know this man? I said, yeah, I know him. He said, did he come to see you? I said, yes. He said, I said, sir, am I in trouble? He says, no, you're not in trouble. I'm not in trouble. He said, I said, he came to see me a few weeks ago. Where was he sitting? I said, he was sitting in that chair right there. He said, can I take a picture of that? I said, yeah, take it. He said, where was you sitting? I said, I was sitting here. He said, can you sit in the chair? I said, no, take the picture empty like there and take it empty over there. He ain't here. What a picture for me for? I've already been to jail. I ain't going back to jail. What you take a picture of me for? He said, what did y'all talk about? I said, I'm not at liberty to share anything that we talked about. He came to see me as one of his priests and a minister, and that is confidential, and I invoke the sanctuary law. He says, no, Bishop Bloom, I'm not accusing you or anything. I just wanted to get an idea because there's some situations with regard to this young man. I said, fine. He said, well, here my card, and if you decide that you want to talk about it, if you remember anything, give me a call. Well, I'm from the project. I ain't going to never remember nothing. Remember what? But the state trooper that was there with me, the FBI agent walked out of the room and was waiting for her. And she turned around and she said to me, she grabbed my hand, she shook it tight and pulled my hand to her. And she says, I thank God for you, Bishop Bloom. And she said, eh, eh. And when she said, eh, eh, I knew she was a believer. Eh, eh, woo. Eh, eh, mm. She said, I thank God for you, Bishop Bloom. She said, I watch your program all the time on Fridays and in the morning. I watch you all the time. And I thank God for you. She said, but let me tell you something. That young man that was in this office 3 weeks ago, They went and they got him out of prison. They cleaned him up and they gave him the money. Yes, sir. They put a wire on him and they set him in your office. She said, for 3 days we were going through voice forensics. We had voice analysis in there, listening to your voices to see if y'all was talking in code. She said, I'm so proud of you on how you lift up the name of Jesus. I'm so glad she couldn't hear what I was thinking. He's a way maker, ain't he? She said, from Fayetteville, North Carolina, from Fayetteville, Oxford, Henderson, down to Creedmoor, into Durham, into Raleigh, into Greensboro, there's a cartel that is hooking up with preachers and they're cleansing the money. And since you used to be in the game and you're a high-profile preacher, they need a high-profile preacher to bring it down so they can get more grants and wants on it. So what they did was they brought him in here to see if they could set you up. And Bishop Bloomer, I'm so proud that you did not fall for it. Then she said something that blew my mind. She said, didn't the Lord say he would rebuke the devourer for our sake? When she said that, then I knew that she wasn't just talking about, the devourer. She was talking about my tithe. See, all of you in here that's been stealing God's tithe, that's the reason why the devourer can come and get you like he gets you. Because there's only one place in the word of God where it says that God will protect you if you would honor what he has given. You ain't saying amen to that, are you? He would protect you if you would honor him with the tithe. She said, I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. I said, my God, and walked out of that office. God protected me. The devil wants you back bad. But look at your neighbor and say, but he can't have me back. He can't have me back. I come to tell you that no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. I come to tell you that I might not be talking to everybody in this room, but there's some old lovers that are trying to get you back. There's some old friends that are trying to get you back. There's some old acquaintances that are showing up trying to get you back. Just when you settled in, just when everything is going good, here comes the Negroes. And I'm telling you to hold on to God's unchanging hands and do not allow the enemy to pull you back in. Learn how to lift up your hands and open up your mouth and give God of praise in spite of all the hell you're going through. Grab your neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, 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 neighbor. Oh, come on, shake that hand. Shake it until you feel some power and say, neighbor, 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 neighbor. The devil wants you back real bad, but you belong to Jesus. Is there anybody in the building that belongs to Jesus? I belong to the Lord and he belongs to me. Open up your mouth and say, I ain't going back. So now is the time to open up your mouth and give the Lord a praise. Where are all the praisers in the building? Because this is the hour to march into the enemy's camp and take back by force everything the devil stole from you. Ball your fists up and pull it to you. Say, I want it back. I want my health back. I want my wealth back. I want my joy back. I want my peace back. I want it all back. Say yes. Open up your mouth and give the Lord a praise in the building. So I went to my lawyer and I said, I don't understand what just transpired, but they tried to set me up in my own office, in my own church. I ain't do nothing wrong this time, and they still came after me. He said, what they do? I told him what they did. He said, how much did they offer you? I said, $7 million. He leaned back and said, you still might get the $7 million. I said, what you mean? He said, they don't have the right to come and try to set you up and don't have no reason to set you up. For the past 3 months, the governor's office been calling me. They done offered me all kinds of land. Y'all in here, all kinds of stuff. I want you to know that this is our season to get back our stuff. Everything he stole from me, I'm gonna get it all back. I'm gonna get it all back. Where are the praisers in the building? I'm trying to find the praisers inside the building, because this is your hour to get your stuff back. The devil tried to set you up, but tell the devil, take your best shot. I might go down, but I'm coming up again. And when I come up, I'm coming
coming up with joy. I'm coming up with peace. I'm coming up with happiness. Grab your neighbor by the hand and say, oh neighbor, before the year's out, I'm gonna have all my stuff. For the devil meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. I'm so glad those Negroes came to the office. I'm so glad they tried to get me like that, because they just signed over to my church $1.5 million grant for 7 years to take care of children. I'm gonna get my stuff. Every time the devil tries to come against you, open up your mouth and say, Lord, I don't know what you're doing, but I'm gonna hold my peace and let you fight my battle. And when I come out of this, it's gonna be all right. Say yes. Look at your neighbor, say, he wants you back, 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 he wants you back. And he wants you back real bad. But I'm not going back to the devil in no form or fashion. I had to cut so many people off in my life because they have the residue of my past on them. It's not that I'm funny or I think that I'm better. I'm just trying to hold on to my sobriety. I'm just trying to hold on to my right mind. Great day in the morning. To coming from the projects, nothing. Nothing. Food stamps and government cheese. To living like I live. Only God. Only God. Before you spend the rest of this afternoon rejoicing in all the Super Bowls, make sure you rejoice in the Super God. Every place the soles of your feet shall tread, it shall be yours. You are about to come into ultra abundance. I wanted to preach here in the first quarter of the year, whether January, February, or March, because I've been having spiritual dreams and visions about you. It's a brand new day. A brand new day, and all of the demonic forces that are trying to block you are going to be sitting on the side of the road scratching their heads. It's a brand new day. And you know, we never talk. I never call you. I'm not a gossiper. And the Lord will share things with people that will hear the sum of a matter and keep it. The Bible said, blessed is the man that hear the sum of the matter and keeps it. But woe be unto the tale bearer. Person that don't even know what they're talking about and they just tweeting it everywhere, retweeting it. I wanted to preach here. I wanted to preach in this pulpit on the closing of an era in your life and the opening of a dispensation. For the fathers of old ate grapes and set their children's teeth on edge is the scripture that we use in spiritual warfare to identify a generational curse. And if you start talking about generational curses, you can pack this house out. Saints love to hear that kind of stuff. But the Bible says that the God of our fathers shall bless you 1,000 times more. That's the scripture that deals with generational blessings. And there are no generational curses assigned to you or you. Only generational blessings. And that's where the battle and the conflict comes from, because Satan knows that he's got to give your children's children's children 1,000 times more. This house will never ever be the same again. For the God who has blessed your pastor is about to bless you. A thousand times more. I'll say this and I'm done. 2 Chronicles 36, around the 20th verse, says, to fulfill the word of the Lord out of the mouth of Jeremiah, the land remained desolate 70 years till the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths. The prophecy of that is simply this. There are no real desolate places. There are no real barren wombs. There are no real droughts. It's God's way of hiding your blessings from people who has the means and the resources to take it from you. So what the Lord does, he allows it to lie dormant, doors falling off. Just looks horrible. And the goody two shoes, they ride past it. And the desolation is God's covering it until you get there to pick it up. In this house, for a number of years, your blessing has been resting. But this is the hour that your blessing is about to wake up. And all of the stuff that's been held up is about to be released. I ain't talking to everybody. I'm talking to folks that understand. This is the hour of transformation. It's a brand new day. And that's why the Lord brought this message today, to let you know that every one of you who are struggling with your past, trying to come and get you back, is because your past knows how good you were at what you did for the enemy. And all God is asking you to do is hold on till reinforcements come. And I want you to do me like you did the devil, and we're going to be straight. Can you do that? Let's give the Lord a praise this morning. Let's give him a praise this morning. I want you to bow your heads. I want you to bow your heads. I want to say this just this way, because sometimes when you're in church, you're in church to the point where you begin to handle church, and that's where you miss God at. This moment right here is a faith moment. And I want to speak to a few people this morning. The altar call today is going to be a call to action. A call to action to every brother who's in this room. A call to action to every sister. A call to action to every business person. A call to action to every person who feels that there's a ministry, there's a calling on your life. It's a call to action. Your blessing is resting. And now is the time to wake it up. I want you to bow your heads. I want to challenge in this room 50 people. 50. This is the year of Jubilee. And I'm not talking about Jubilee on television. I'm talking about Jubilee in the Bible. This is the year of Jubilee. And in the year of Jubilee, it always hit during the season of famine and drought. And the people went beyond what they could see and seeded into what did not look like anything to seed into and reap the harvest. Rough times have been in front of all of us. I didn't come to get your money. I'm not broke. This is not a gig for me. If you're going to give and complain, keep it in your pocket. If you feel pressure, don't give nothing. We have no cahoots in the back room. But I promise you, if you sow a seed today under the anointing of this preach word that George Bloomer preached in this room, two things will happen. Three things, actually. You release in your life supernatural joy, supernatural healing, and supernatural money. I promise you. Your broke days will cease and come to an end. Miracles will be your portion, supernaturally. I know you've heard everything. I'm speaking to your spirit and not to your intellect. There are 50 of you in this room that needs to place your hands on your substance, your checkbook, your credit card, your debit card, or cash, and plan to sow a seed in this room of $108. 108. 108. A
And you need to start moving to this altar as quickly as you possibly can. Hold it and let us pray this prayer over your life. 108. 108. Even if you have to write your check standing up here, start moving. Start moving. 50. Penta. Pentecost. Jubilee. In the name of Jesus. 108. 108. 108. Shakataba. 108. 108. There are three people in this room today. One, two, three people in this room today who's been really battling with your business and your children and your health. Three of you here today. This 108 won't move anything for you in the spirit realm. Your seed challenge today is $500. And you need to come and release that thing. And you're not given to be seen, but you need to be seen given. There are three of you that need to place a seed of $500 in my hand and let me rebuke this curse over your business, over your health, over your finances. In the name of Jesus, you're here today. You're here today. Please, ma'am, sir, do not treat this like a regular service. Do not treat this like a regular preacher coming in just to get your money. Please, please, today, respond and get your blessing. We're those three persons whose seed is $500. I need to see you right here. I didn't make a mistake. I'm not calling out numbers. That's the word of the Lord for you, and it will break in your life as you obey God. A sacrifice is not measured by how much you give. A sacrifice is measured by how much you have left. How much you have left? $500. Where are you? Where are you? Where are you? That's one. Clap those hands. Where's number two? Where are you? Where are you? Where are you? Break forth. Break past. Let's believe God for this. Let's believe God first. Remember, I wasn't on the schedule. This is not a planned meeting. This is a divine appointment. This is a divine appointment. He's going to shift your business. He's going to change things for you. Get it and start walking. There are two others. The Holy Spirit is just pulling on my spirit. There's two others. Your seed assignment is $500. Start walking this way. $500. It's $500. $500. There are 50 of you in this room whose seed challenge is 108. Get it and honor the Lord with it. Get it and honor the Lord with it. Get it and honor the Lord with it. You're sowing that 108. Hold it up. Hold it up. We're going to bless God in this place. Hold it up. Hold it up. Thank you, Holy Spirit. He just stopped me again. There are two of you whose seed challenge is $500. Get it. Obey God. It's not going to work when the service is over and you run and say, I was supposed to give this. This is the opportunity for you to obey and release. Father, in the name of Jesus, loose this in this place in the name of Jesus. Bless you so much. That's number two. You're standing with that too? No, that's number two. There's one other. Somebody clap those hands. I know God is speaking. Woo! I know he's speaking. 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 I want you to hold that seat up of 108. And I want you to talk to it. And then I want you to place it in my hand. And when you place it in my hand, I want you to say release. Release. Because it's going to release some stuff for you. Father, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus that your people are moving in obedience. We release this financial blessing and anointing on them and on their lives today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Place it in my hand and say release in Jesus' name. There you go. I want everyone in this room that can find a $20 seed to get it, open it up. Don't ball it up. Open it up. Bring it like you're going to bring it to Walmart. Open it up and stand on your feet. Let's shift something in this atmosphere in the name of Jesus. If you don't have 20, say to your neighbor, lend me $20. I ain't going to pay you back, but lend it to me anyway. Get a $20 seed in your hand and stand on your feet. I'm believing God that 100 of you would do it in the name of Jesus. Get that seed. Get that seed and start walking this way. Get that seed and start walking this way. It's a new season, brand new day, fresh anointing,
fresh anointing
coming,
it's coming my way.
Season of power,
season of power,
open that seat up
and prosperity. It's a new season coming to me.
Oh, it's a new season.
It's a new season.
It's a new day.
It's a new day.
Fresh anointing.
Fresh anointing.
Coming my way.
It's coming my way.
Season of power.
Season of power.
Yeah. Praise the Lord, Greater Emmanuel. Please focus your attention on these very important ministry announcements. Today, Ministry Coordinator Joanne Brown would like to meet with the members of the CWC, YWCC, Nurses Guild, Singles Ministry, and the Single Parent Ministry in the Cathedral Choir Stand immediately following 11:30 a.m. worship service. The Kids with Voices for Jesus will rehearse at 7 p.m. Wednesday, February 10th during Midweek Motivation. Please see Sister Tasha Nolan for more information. The Senior Connect meeting will be held Friday, February 12th at 6 p.m. in Conference Room A. And then at 7 p.m., the Women and Men's Department of Greater Emmanuel present a special evening of breakout sessions. These informative gatherings will run concurrently. All members are encouraged to attend. The Trailblazers present a trip to see Monster Jam, Saturday, February 27th. Tickets are just $17 per child if purchased by Friday, February 12th. For more information, see Evangelist Nikenta Royals. All are welcome to participate in the prayer lock-in on Tuesday, February 16th at 5 a.m. in the temple. Doors will be locked promptly at 5:15 a.m. The Single Parent Ministry will meet at 6 p.m. in the social area Thursday, February 18th. All single parents are encouraged to attend. Elder William Adams and Evangelist Denise Jones are the coordinators. The Greater Emmanuel Food Distribution Ministry and our partners, Forgotten Harvest and Gleaners Community Food Bank, will distribute food Saturday, February 20th from 11 a.m. until 2 p.m. on the 7-mile lot. Volunteers are needed. Please see Sister Gloria Conyers for further information. The members and parents of the Emmanuel Voices are asked to assemble for a very important meeting on Saturday, February 13th from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. in the temple. For more information, please see Elder Cadero Brown or Brother John Norwood. Your participation is appreciated in advance. Please remember our weekly services on Sundays at 7:30 a.m., Tuesdays at 12 noon and 7 p.m. are hours of prayer. Wednesdays at 11:45 a.m. and 7 p.m. is Midweek Motivation. And Fridays at 7 p.m. is our evangelistic service. Please come out and be blessed by these Spirit-filled services. We are Greater Emmanuel, a church driven by the cross.
I'm sure the word of God has penetrated your heart and caused you to want to make some changes in your life. If you don't know the Lord, listen, don't leave the way you've come. Come now and give your life to the Lord. He wants to save you. Behold, he stands at the door of your heart knocking. He's not intrusive, but you've got to invite him in. Why don't you say with me that you want God to come into your heart? I'm going to say a sinner's prayer, and if you'll repeat it after me, that's just how simple it is for you to be saved. Lord, I'm a sinner, and I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins and grant to me the right to be called one of your kingdom citizens. In Jesus' name, amen. If you said that, and you believe it in your heart, you're saved. Now we're welcoming you into the GEI Church. God bless you, my friends, and my brothers and sisters. Continue to go forward in the Lord. Everyone is standing. Let's praise God for the word. Come on, praise God for the word.